We're going to discuss another CEDIA Award winner. The name of this project, Religious Intent, I'll ask you about that in a minute, exactly what that means here. My name is Ed Wank. I'm the content director for CEDIA. And we're going to talk about a CEDIA Award-winning project. We're talking about a very large site here. This is five separate buildings, gardens, and SONA had to approach this as a single project. The client wanted a wireless network seamless across the site, covering every building and the exterior spaces between. We're talking about 150 meters between these buildings in some cases, delivering music and TV content throughout the main house, the annex, the summer house, the gardens. Simon Folstow handled this for SONA. He is the design and technical director for SONA, and Paul Cummin joins us as well from Artcoustic. Hi, guys. How are you?
Good, thank you. And you?
I'm very well. Good. So, as usual, you get the directive from the client. I want the tech to be unobtrusive, which is something you hear, I'm sure, on every job, right?
It's the standard request, yeah.
So how do you attack that for a property, especially one this large?
Yeah, we were lucky here in that there was a very involved interior designer who we met with at our first meeting with the client. So she was very involved from the outset, had very clear ideas. So that made a huge difference that she was open to technology. She appreciated that the client wanted that and wanted quite a lot of it, and that we had technical requirements and functionality that we needed to hit to give the client what they wanted.
Gotcha.
But she was able to give us, and she did give us very clear direction on, look, I do not want to see speakers in these rooms. I do not want to see TVs. So if you have a TV, that is fine, but we need to work together to kind of make that happen. So a lot of detail drawings from us, elevations to be approved and things like that.
And this project took, what, 2 years, you said?
In total, yeah, probably from our initial meeting through to completion. And it was slightly phased in its delivery in that some of the building was a main house and a separate annex that had the cinema and an office building and then some garden buildings, some, I call them greenhouses, but they're very large greenhouses. They're all finished kind of at different times. So that is good in terms of, from a delivery point of view, you can stretch out the delivery, but bad in terms of a lot of our core equipment is in one building that was finished at different times from other buildings.
Uh-huh.
So we try as a company to try and pre-build and pre-configure everything off-site and then bring it all to site in one go. That's somewhat difficult when one rack is needed to deliver part of the building and site before the rest of the house is ready.
So how do you contend with a long project like this, a two-year project like this, massive space? Let's say, for example, that 4K appears in the middle of the project and suddenly is like becoming popular and the client hears about it and says, hey, let's add this. Oh, great. Now I got to start over from scratch. How do you approach that? How do you build that into the project?
I think because of the nature of this project and the disparate buildings, it became quite obvious that we were going to have to look for a network solution.
Okay.
Some of the distances that we were looking at were just that we needed to send video were over 100 meters in some cases.
And keep it seamless.
Exactly. So we essentially designed a managed network where each of the buildings are connected by fiber.
All right.
And all of the audio, the video, the CCTV cameras, everything sits on that core network. And that actually gave us quite a lot of flexibility, because once that core network was in place and designed, we could, to a certain extent, bolt most of what we needed to onto that and just either increase switch size or uplink size to cope with that.
At what point did you bring in Mr. Cummin and Artcoustic?
The cinema was obviously quite a big part of this build. It was individually quite a large spend, and we're lucky to have a relationship with Paul and with Artcoustic where we're a very small team. So part of the relationship I have with them is being able to almost treat them like another member of our team when we're doing initial. We're quite good in that we've got very, very detailed internal resource to be able to produce drawings and documentation, but it's extremely useful to sometimes be able to just bounce those ideas off someone who's making those speakers and delivering those speakers and has a lot of experience in other cinemas of a similar size where the client's looking for a similar thing. So we deal with Paul, we treat it like he's almost as another member of the team sometimes for this.
Tell us what you brought to the table.
The specification stage, wasn't it, really? So
from
looking at the drawings and the plans of the room, then making sure that the technical aspects, regardless of anything out there, financial or aesthetic, was making sure the technical sides are correct. The industry standards that we all know and love, working towards those, and building in the headroom. We're fortunate enough with this one to I think we got 105 plus 6 dB in the listening position, so we had all that extra headroom available to us.
So did you have any specific challenges with this one that troubled
not
you?
Not at the beginning.
Yeah, this is quite...
Not at the beginning?
It's quite interesting. I was listening to your podcast about the awards and how documenting everything, because the awards judges don't know if you don't tell them.
Right.
And this is a brilliant example of that, because this cinema started off with quite a high spec. We were kind of like at reference levels plus 6 dB at the listening position, and then the front soundstage was purchased and almost started to be installed when we had some issues with physical space in the room and in the ceiling, which meant that we physically couldn't fit the speakers we needed to into.
Oh, no.
There was no budget. Some of it had already been purchased. So we basically had to down spec the height channels and the surround channels to physically fit what we could fit. We didn't explain that fully in our CEDIA award, so although that room was individually shortlisted for a CEDIA award, we didn't win, and that part of that is probably because we weren't explicit enough in our descriptions in our award entry. So that's quite a... If you don't tell them, they don't know.
Did Artcoustic work on the theatre alone, or did you...
I think it was, wasn't it?
It's collaborative.
With you guys, obviously.
Yeah, with us, yeah. But yeah, so it was only Artcoustic who we went to for that initial design phase and kind of... And fleshing out the design. And
although we obviously have a natural bias towards the audio, because that's what we do.
Of course.
We also take a holistic approach to make sure the screen size versus viewing distance and the brightness, and sort of bouncing off ideas. You know, have we checked the foot lamberts? Have we checked the viewing angles? Do the sight lines work? Stuff that isn't actually, strictly speaking, our role, because we're an audio company. But clearly, it's a holistic system. The system has to work as a whole rather than just sounds great, but I can't see the picture.
So what did you use for delivering the image? And
It's a Sony projector,
okay.
550 from memory, but fully calibrated, drives and loot. It's fed from a Kaleidoscope Strato 4K player and an Oppo Blu-ray. It's also got access to two Skyboxes and two Apple TVs through a Just Add Power IP system.
Mm-hmm.
Anything else? No, that's the...
No, is the theatre...
It's got an anamorphic... There's an anamorphic system in there, so side masking screen. So it's
okay.
A native 2.4:1 screen that masks into 16:9 and 4:3.
That's great. The racks, apparently you didn't have a lot of room to work with.
Well, yeah, there are actually two racks in this house. So that's in the annex, the basement, which actually we had quite a lot of space. But the main house where... the majority of the audio distribution is, and all of the network for that house and the audio amplification, we had literally a cupboard. And Paul's visited this site. He can vouch for this, that when you close the door on that cupboard, there is literally 5 mil between the front of the cable.
I mentioned it as soon as I saw it.
And the back of the...
That's close.
It was literally where we had to laser measure that room and map it out, placed a rack in it, because we were like, this is simply not good. And you open this kind of double cupboard on the hallway, and it's just rammed full of lighting panels, and so ventilating that space was a challenge. And we had to change from it's a Sonos system throughout here, but we changed from their units had integrated amps to their separate preamps with multi-channel power amps, simply because it saved us a couple of rack space. It was getting that tight in there.
When you automated the house, you had outdoor and indoor events, is that correct?
Yeah, so there's quite a lot of lighting exterior, and also a lot of non-lighting fixtures or non-traditional lighting fixtures that are integrated with the Lutron system. So there's a lot of water features. There's a swimming pond outside, and there's fountains and waterfalls and weirs and that run alongside the house that are all on the Lutron system, and they're all interfaced on automated sequences, so they run at certain times of the year at different times. There's outdoor points for Christmas lights on the gas lanterns that only activate from beginning of December to beginning of January. So there's quite a lot of events like that are all automated, require no input from the client. There's natural gas lanterns as well, so the client does quite a lot of work in the centre of London, and he really loves these old, they're in Kensington, these old natural gas lanterns.
Oh.
So we actually, the company who makes them for London Council for they approached that company and they had those made around the property. And we've also, they made us some custom versions to house cameras in. So there's some of those that have actually got cameras and PA horns for the CCTV, but look like CCTV. Sorry, look like natural gas lantern post.
That's great.
But they're triggered through the Lutron again, so you've got these natural gas flames that are all triggered off the Lutron system.
And you've got to make it work with the interior lighting as well, so it's kind of a seamless aesthetic experience.
Yeah,
and,
absolutely.
Talk about the challenges that you encountered there.
I think that, again, I think, as Dean Oliver mentioned before, we're quite lucky there. The interior designers, quite often our projects are quite, they've got quite a lot of focus on the lighting design, but they don't have a lot of focus on the technical elements of that. Mm-hmm. So on this project in particular, but on, to be honest, quite a lot of our projects, we're giving a lighting plan, but then we try and get involved to circuit that. So, yes, you've got 20 downlights in this room, but maybe we shouldn't switch them all together. Maybe we should separate them, and maybe let's move some out to the walls to actually create some scene and some function in here, rather than just all your downlights are on or on off.
Yep.
Yeah.
I'm going to slap them in and see what happens.
Yeah. Architects seem to have a particular tendency to just put downlights in as part of their electrical layouts without really working with the interior layout.
So was that a tough conversation? How did you approach that? How do you approach that conversation?
It wasn't really. It can be on certain projects. This one was a good one. So the interior designer, Keely Green, who was a family friend actually of the client. So she had a very close relationship with the client. So a lot of times we were able to circumvent conversations that traditionally would have probably required us to have a discussion with the interior designer and decide something between us, then have to go to the client to get sign-off approval on that. She was really speaking for the client a lot of the time, almost in the first person. So we could have a lot of those conversations directly with her and get agreement without necessarily having to go to the client and go back to various iterations. So on this particular project, that was actually quite a pleasant experience. Not always the case, but
in this case it was. So I'm seeing, you know, this is obviously a youngster's room.
Yeah.
And there's integration. So that means there's control.
Yeah.
That that's gonna have peanut butter on it at some point.
Absolutely.
If you're not careful. So talk about, you know, ensuring that the controls were intuitive enough for such a broad age range of users.
Well, there's our approach with, well, iPads are very popular these days, as I'm sure everyone uses them. But, and we went through a stage a couple of years ago where that's all that clients were asking for, that's all that we were delivering. But we realized quite quickly that iPads are fantastic. They offer a very cost-effective introduction to a lovely, very reactive touch panel. But as a tactile interface to a system, they're not actually very practical. If you are trying to navigate something which has a visual interface like Apple TV or Sky, and you're using a pad that has no tactile feedback whatsoever, if you're navigating up, down, left, right, your finger has a tendency to shy away from that and there's no feedback. Also, practically, if that iPad is used for email and social media and checking the stocks or checking the weather, and you are watching a film or watching a sports match and someone rings the bell, or you just want to pause or just the volume, you've got to unlock it. You unlock it, or someone's in a different app, you have to switch to it. By the time you've done that, it's kind of, so we paired that on all of our projects, on this one, with a handheld remote with hard buttons, so that in all of these rooms, you've got something that is purely dedicated to controlling the system, and you can pick that up and it always does. You can hit pause, you can hit volume, knows what the rest of the system's done. So even if someone has turned that room on with an iPad, the handheld remote knows that that iPad has turned on to Sky. It has changed its function in the background. So you can pick that handheld remote up. You don't have to tell it you're using Sky, it knows. And the kids, I think their kids maybe four and five, and they use the handheld remotes.
Yep. They figure it out quick.
Yeah.
It's always surprising.
Quicker than the adults. Yeah.
So did you also integrate climate and security? And
no, on this job, we didn't. There's a really, really, not complicated, but quite an involved BMS system on this that we had. We opened ports and gave them network connectivity, but it was quite an isolated system. Oh. So there's a different company managing the air conditioning and underfloor heating. And we take quite a pragmatic approach to how much interface we give with that as a business. Most of our clients talk about it, and a lot of clients kind of say, I'm going to want my heating on the iPad as part of that. But the majority of projects we worked in have large underfloor wet heating systems.
Okay.
And they do not react to adding a couple of degrees on in 5 or 10 minutes. So if you are sat on the sofa watching TV and you are feeling a bit chilly, turning the underfloor heating up by a couple of degrees is not really going to do anything for a couple of hours. So there's obviously costs and additional complication added with that. And we try to have a conversation with the client and say, well, look, you can, we can do that, absolutely. But as part of our client discussion and as part of our client discovery, often that money is better spent elsewhere on maybe a nicer quality TV in the family room, or maybe surround sound in the family room. And with all these things, it's something that could be added.
I want to come back to the theater so that we get Paul back involved again. So at what point during the discovery process did you determine that we're not going to have a media room, we're going to have this home theater, we're really going to have a dedicated cinema?
It was an interesting one, this, because as silly as it sounds, it was when we got the set of plans, there was a room that had cinema on it.
Okay.
And
Simply put, literally
that. And I think, and I'm reading between the lines here, but I think that was probably because they didn't really know what to do with it. It was a house of a certain value, and they thought, oh, well, it'd be nice to have a private cinema. But the client had not had one before. They'd not experienced one. So we were given quite a lot of freedom in terms of, here is a room within reason. You can kind of do what you want with it. We want it to look a certain way, and the interior designer has complete freedom on that. But what do you suggest? So it was quite a nice one in that we could initially, and I mentioned earlier, we went in with quite a high spec. I think it's it was in the 40 to 120,000 cinema bracket there. So I think it's about a £90,000 cinema.
That's nice.
This.
Yeah.
It did start off higher than that originally, but budget constraints, and as the project progresses, these things change. But we were able to kind of start with a room and go to Paul Atkins and say, look,
it was nice from the beginning. We had the drawings from it, and so there's a double door, or the door was in the right place that the speakers were, you know, on the perfect map, so they could go in all the right angles, all the right positions. Like, this is a dream. It's everything's working out perfectly.
Yeah.
So the freedom was refreshing. So we had a designer system based on, without the compromises that often get in there with windows, doors, and other problems. I think one of the, other than the compromises you had to make with the specs because of the lack of space on the rears and overheads, I think the solution with the artwork was pretty cool.
Oh, talk about that then.
Yeah, so was that your idea, Neil?
That was my idea,
It came out really well. So as a speaker brand, we obviously have a range of speakers, but we also can do a lot of printing and colours as well, so we can work on the aesthetic side of the products to make them blend in or stand out or whatever works for the aesthetic. And in this case, is quite an unusual but smart move, is the movie prints on the walls are our speaker fabric printed. So behind the Pulp Fiction one, I think, is one of the speakers. Behind the other one is nothing. So it was a good way of incorporating the speakers behind. So they're not on show, they're nicely hidden.
Sure.
And work with the room. So
how many channels of audio are we talking here? What kind of system are we talking?
714?
That's just, you know, like, so 714, yeah.
714.
Yeah.
That's terrific. And what's powering the speakers?
It's Anthem. Yeah. Anthem processor with separate power amplification, yeah.
So again, all that calibration via the ARC and all tested. So we get involved with the calibration side as well to make sure that it delivers on the initial dream.
So this is like four seats and three lounge theater, I guess you'd call it.
Yeah.
From the looks of things, is that the setup here?
Yeah.
There's four at the back, isn't there?
There's, four across the back.
Oh, okay.
And then two, like, day bed type areas at the front.
Gotcha. Yeah. Did you have any isolation issues to deal with here?
Actually, above this room is actually the client's main office.
Oh,
so that was, we identified that quite early on and said, look, we're going to be generating some fairly serious levels here.
Yeah.
Is this a room that is going to be in use when you are trying to work and trying to have a phone conversation? And we did look at isolating that room, but it was essentially price was an issue. It simply didn't make for the amount of times that the client thought he would be using that room and wanting to work versus the price it would have been to isolate it. And we were already quite tight with, so I know it looks like a huge room, but some of the ceiling heights in there and some of the spaces we had to work with in the room for the seating layout that they wanted. We were quite restricted, and to build isolation within that would have been quite restrictive. So their client ultimately made the choice, you know, I do not mind if I am in that room using it, I will not be working. Or if someone is in that room using it, I will not be working.
This sounds like kind of a dream gig, this particular job.
We were given a huge amount of freedom. The client was very clear in that our approach with all clients is we try not to talk really about technology. Part of our interview process is to learn about them and their family. How do you currently live and use your house, and how do you see that changing? Would you like that to change as part of this house? And how can we use technology, leverage technology to make that a nicer experience for you, to make your home a better place to be in, whether that's more entertaining, whether it's more relaxing, whether it's more intuitive. So that was very clear from the outset that where they wanted to listen to music, where they wanted to watch video. Mm-hmm. And other than the specific kind of caveats of we do not want to see TVs in this room, or we do not want to see speakers in this room when they're not in use, we were actually given a huge amount of freedom. And this was quite a high budget project, which is always makes life a bit easier, because sure, you do have access to a bigger portfolio of products, and you're able to spend more time on the design and the installation and the integration of those. You do end up with a very nice product at the end of it.
So the distances between buildings is a benefit, because it's easier to upgrade in the future when you're running fiber, right?
Yes. Yeah. Okay. So the fiber, we've got fiber between the buildings that would, within reason, allow us to do pretty much anything. We can add any number of video zones on any of the additional buildings. We can add audio, although to be fair, that we couldn't add a lot more audio on this house. There's quite a lot of audio already.
That's terrific.
Yeah.
Do we have any questions for the gents? Does anybody have any questions about this particular project? This great five building project here in Britain. Where is it in Britain?
It's in the northwest.
In the northwest.
Near Chester. Yeah.
All right. Fantastic. Simon Falstow is the design and technical director with SONA. Paul Cummin is with Artcoustic. So do you use the awards for marketing?
Absolutely.
Uh-huh.
Absolutely, yeah. Okay. They're a huge... And to be honest, even we consider being shortlisted, it is a huge accolade for us. The competition that you're up against globally now is incredible. So for us to be...
And getting better every
year.
And
gets better every year. Yeah. So for us, and a lot of people, I realise people just seeing the photography and seeing the project price and stuff, the amount of detail that we have to provide to CEDIA, the amount of technical information, the time that goes into producing that, the essay questions is... Like, to do that, there's a huge amount of resource, but a huge amount of work and kind of development and design that goes into them. So for someone to actually turn around and say, you know what, that we are shortlisting you are competitive with all these other your peers who we consider and who we look up to is an incredible achievement for us. And for us to be able to say to our clients, look, we are not just, it's not just me telling you we're doing a good job, here's some imperial kind of some independent evidence,
right,
that the systems you're getting from us, the level of design, the level of installation is up there with the best companies in the world. And that,
do you know how many trophies you picked up from CEDIA over the years?
I think actual wins, I think we've won 3 awards, but I think we've been in total, in terms of highly commended and shortlisted, about 12 or 13, maybe. Don't hold me to that, but it's about 10-ish, man.
I believe you.
Yeah.
So more information on Artcoustic, where can they go for Artcoustic? URL?
In what sense?
Where can people find out more information about Artcoustic?
We have a stand here. So,
okay, that's a start.
Come see us in Hall 5 or artcoustic.com, obviously.
Wonderful. And Sona, what's your URL?
It's Sona, S-O-N-A .technology.
Gentlemen, thanks. Congratulations on the
Thank
win.
You very
Great
much.
Project.
Thank
Appreciate
you.
It. Round of applause, please.
Thank you. Thank you.